Good afternoon, and welcome to this RFF live event, Looking Ahead, Benefit Cost Analysis for Environmental Regulation. I'm Dick Morgenstern, the Senior Fellow here at RFF. At the outset, I want to thank the 1,000+ people who signed up for this important event. For those of you not familiar with RFF, we are an independent nonprofit research institution based in Washington. We were founded almost 70 years ago. Our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. One way we do this is through virtual events like this one, by bringing together leading experts to develop new and shared understandings of crucial policy and economic issues. Today, we'll be discussing some of the changes the Trump administration adopted in the conduct and use of benefit cost analysis for environmental decision making. And we'll consider the future of these economic analyses in rulemaking, and we'll ask why it matters. We're pleased to be joined by all of our distinguished guests, especially Michael Livermore and Ricky Revesz, who are authors of a fabulous new book entitled Reviving Rationality, Saving Cost-Benefit Analysis for the Sake of the Environment and Our Health. Ricky is currently the Lawrence King Professor of Law and Dean Emeritus at the New York University School of Law. He's also the founder and director of the Institute of Policy Integrity, on whose advisory board I serve. Michael is currently a law professor at the University of Virginia and previously executive director of the Institute of Policy Integrity. I think I neglected to mention, or maybe I did mention, that Ricky is currently was the founder and director of that institute. Their first co-authored book back in 2008, entitled Retaking Rationality, was highly influential in the regulatory world. It argued that progressive opposition to benefit cost analysis was both ineffective and counterproductive. The timing of today's event could not be more propitious. It was just yesterday that EPA issued a final and controversial rule on the use of economics in rulemaking, a topic that is central to our discussion today. Following Ricky and Michael's presentations, they will be joined by four additional experts, all of whom have distinguished academic credentials and relevant government and regulatory experience. Sally Katzen is currently a professor of law at NYU and serves as co-chair of the RFF's President's Council. Previously, she served as the OIRA administrator in the Clinton administration. Alan Krupnik is my colleague and collaborator here at RFF. He's also a senior fellow. He served on the staff of the Council of Economic Advisors during the Clinton administration. Joe Aldi is a public policy professor at Harvard's Kennedy School, and is also a university fellow here at RFF. He served in the Obama White House and previously on the staff of the CEA. Jonathan Weiner is currently a professor at the Duke University Law School, and previously he held positions at the Justice Department and CEA. While not attempting to constrain the scope of their remarks, I have asked each of the presenters to touch on four key questions concerning the future of benefit cost analysis of environmental regulation. First, a reflection on the Trump administration's approach to the issue. What are the strengths and weaknesses of the Trump approach? Second, a look at whether there are any innovations introduced by the Trump administration that might become permanent features of the regulatory process. Third, I've asked them to comment on an issue which was actually specifically addressed in the Revesz Livermore book on transparency of science and the reproducibility of study results. Specifically, what is the best way to reconcile the competing views of different disciplines and interest groups on the issue of data sharing? Lastly, I've asked each panelist to reflect on both the hopes and the concerns they have for for the future of benefit cost analysis in coming years. Let me turn quickly to a few housekeeping issues. This public webinar is being recorded and will be posted on the RFF website afterwards. All audience members are muted and invisible, and you should only see the panelists on your screen. As time allows, we'll be opening up the webinar to audience Q&A, and we encourage you to submit your questions at any point in the webinar to the Q&A box, which you can find at the bottom of your screen. The sooner you submit, the better, I would suggest. We'll be monitoring questions and we'll try to get as many as we can. Lastly, if you want to join the conversation on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. With that, let's dive in. Michael and Ricky, I'll hand things over to you guys first.
Great. Thanks so much, Dick. And thanks to all the panelists and the participants. Ricky, did you want to?
No.
Yep. And so, I'll just get us started with maybe a few remarks about Reviving Rationality, our new book. So as you mentioned, in a sense, this is a follow-up to a book that we wrote together and published in 2008, Retaking Rationality. And that first, both of these books explore political dynamics around the use of cost-benefit analysis and regulatory decision-making with something of an emphasis on environmental regulatory decision-making, but also more broadly. In that first book, we were really looking at some of the interest group dynamics about the organizations that tended to support cost-benefit analysis and others that were skeptical. And in this book, we're really taking a step back and looking at some of the continuity that we've seen over the very long history, or reasonably long history, of the use of cost-benefit analysis in regulation, and then examining some of the recent breaks with that tradition. As you mentioned, we're going to be talking a little bit about the last 4 years under the Trump administration. So, but before turning to that, it is worth emphasizing the importance of cost-benefit analysis in regulatory decision-making in the United States. So this is an institution that's been around for a very long time. There are precursors even before the Reagan administration, but it was the Reagan administration that adopted its executive order, empowering the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs to oversee major regulatory decisions that were adopted by agencies and requiring agencies to engage in cost-benefit analysis. And so, we're now coming up on, or we're at 40 years of this institution being around, and it has had a substantial influence in shaping how regulatory decisions are made in the US. One of the important characteristics of that history is that there's been quite a bit of continuity between administrations of both political parties. We live in a very polarized time, and so it's useful to recognize where there's areas of disagreement. And of course, the Reagan administration and the Clinton administration and the first Bush administration and the second Bush administration and the Obama administration disagreed about many features of regulatory policy. They had different areas that they were interested in emphasizing. They were just more generally in terms of what their agendas were, but also with respect to cost-benefit analysis. But one of the important characteristics of this kind of 40-year or 35-year time span prior to Trump is the amount of agreement between administrations and how to carry out cost-benefit analysis. And so the way we describe this in the book is as a set of guardrails, that there's a legitimate room, of course, in a democratic society for political influence over agency decision-making, because agencies make important decisions, and we want agencies to be accountable to the people. But at the same time, administrations of both parties agreed that expertise, analysis, and evidence was a valuable input into regulatory decision-making. And the format of cost-benefit analysis, the procedure of cost-benefit analysis and regulatory review, was how that commitment to evidence analysis and expertise was essentially instantiated by administrations of both political parties. So in Retaking Rationality, we take that story up to the beginning of, or the end of, George W. Bush administration. Again, focusing on those interest group dynamics. And in Reviving Rationality, we focus on the 8 years of the Obama administration and then the first few years of the Trump administration. The book was written before the outcome of the election was known. And so I'll maybe just spend a few minutes talking about what we learned about cost-benefit analysis during the Obama administration, and then Ricky might pick us up there. So under President Obama, one of the most important developments was really a synthesis of quite a strong progressive regulatory agenda with a strong commitment to cost-benefit analysis. And of course, this was something that we saw during the Clinton administration as well, but what really shifted during the Obama administration was two things. One is that many of the progressive groups that had opposed cost-benefit analysis, even during the Clinton administration, I think came to see the value of this technique, that it's often the case that when you do a careful analysis of costs and benefits, stringent protections for public health are well justified, stringent protections for the environment are well justified. And so groups came to recognize that fact. Now, the other side of the equation was the success of the Obama administration in achieving this synthesis. And it really was, you know, a strong progressive regulatory agenda. And, you know, Cass Sunstein was in the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, someone who's been a major proponent of cost-benefit analysis for many years. And, but what ended up happening is folks who were skeptical of that regulatory agenda, who were, you know, the industry groups who would bear costs, others who had ideological or political reasons to be oppositional to the Obama administration. In the past, many of these groups would have endorsed cost-benefit analysis, but during the course of the Obama administration, they really started to work to change the conversation away from rational regulation and accounting for regulatory effects, looking at general well-being of the American people, and instead deploying certain rhetorical moves to, again, shift the conversation. So one of these rhetorical moves was introducing this idea of a job-killing regulations, or accusing the administration of carrying out a regulatory tsunami, or engaging in a war on coal. And this isn't, you know, a careful conversation about costs and benefits. This is really just rhetorical tools that again shifted the conversation away from this, away from costs and benefits. Because the fact of the matter was, for many regulatory decisions during the Obama administration, the reality was that there were very strong, well-supported analyses showing very, very large net benefits. And this is true of air quality rules. It's several air quality rules, major air quality rules. It's true of rules on greenhouse gas emissions in the transportation sector. And so, you know, finding themselves unable to make a case on costs and benefits, they shifted the terrain. And what that ended up doing is, in a sense, inverting the polarity, the political polarity around cost-benefit analysis, where the groups that had been traditional opponents were at least comfortable with cost-benefit analysis most of the time during the Obama administration, and groups that had been more traditional opponents of cost-benefit analysis, groups that had been more traditional supporters of cost-benefit analysis, instead inverting their view, and if not directly undermining cost-benefit analysis, sometimes that happened, but certainly often shifting the conversation away from cost-benefit analysis because they didn't see that as fruitful kind of rhetorical and political terrain. So Ricky, maybe I'll, so that kind of takes us up to the end of the Obama administration. So maybe I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you.
Pass the ball to you.
Thanks so much, Dick, for hosting this program, and thanks to RFF for putting together this this event with these great commentators and such a big audience. So one of Dick's questions was, how far out of the mainstream was the Trump administration's approach to cost-benefit analysis? Are these mostly matters of technical disagreement for which reasonable people might come to different conclusions? And part two of the book very strongly takes a position that the Trump administration was very much out of the mainstream, and these are not matters of technical disagreement for which reasonable people might come to different conclusions. And I'll give some examples of that. So one of the moves that the Trump administration made, that the book discusses in some length, involves the treatment of co-benefits, that is the indirect benefits of regulation, Today is a propitious day to discuss that because just yesterday, the Trump administration finalized the rule that is one of a number of elements in its policy to call into question taking co-benefits into account in evaluating regulatory policies. This issue first arose and arose in the starkest context in connection with the Trump administration's decision find that the regulation of the hazardous air pollutant emissions of power plants was not appropriate and necessary. And it did it based on an economic analysis that ignored between $36 and $90 billion of benefits. The costs were $9.6 billion. So this was a regulation that had extraordinarily attractive net benefits ranging from around $30 billion to around $90 billion. And the Trump administration decided to disregard those and as a result determined that the regulation of hazardous air pollutants was not appropriate and necessary. The indirect benefits came from particulate matter reductions. They were indirect because under the section of the statute under which this regulation was promulgated, that section directly was about regulating hazardous air pollutants and particulate matter under the lingo of the Clean Air Act is a criteria pollutant that's governed by a different section. But they were not indirect in a way that suggested they weren't real. I mean, they were very much real benefits. There were tens of thousands of people dying a year as a result of this. The Trump administration decided to disregard that. Now, disregarding that is inconsistent with the practices of both administrations, administrations of both parties going back to the Reagan administration. Every administration, beginning with Ronald Reagan, took into account co-benefits in evaluating federal regulation. It's also inconsistent with the approach of Circular A4, which is the OMB circular that provides guidance to agencies on how they conduct cost-benefit analyses. And which is in effect, and which at least in principle informs the actions of every administration, including the Trump administration. Now, while the Trump administration is calling co-benefits into question, it is privileging and broadly considering indirect costs. So it's basically saying the indirect consequences of regulation must be taken into account if they are negative, and must be ignored if they are positive. Now, one of the nice things about judicial review of agency action is that it's governed by a standard in the Administrative Procedure Act that's called arbitrary and capricious. And it's hard to imagine something more arbitrary and more capricious than insisting on broadly counting indirect consequences if they are negative and ignoring them if they are positive. Now, this would be bad enough if it ended there, but it actually gets a lot worse because the Trump administration is actually not willing to consistently apply this policy, however misguided it might be. In some cases, taking co-benefits into account can make a deregulatory policy look more palatable. And that was the case with the rollback of the clean car standards. That's the EPA regulation of greenhouse gas emissions of automobiles, which was coupled with the Department of Transportation's corporate average fuel economy standards for automobiles. That regulation is one that has negative net benefits, even under the analysis of the Trump administration. And they're pretty explicit about that. But whatever benefits it has are co-benefits. So without the co-benefits, it would have vastly negative net benefits. So the co-benefits and what the Trump administration talks about a lot in justifying the rollback of the CAR standards, pretty much all they talk about, is the safety benefits that would come from this rule. Now, there are all kinds of modeling problems that might make you take those safety benefits, call those safety benefits into question. But for these purposes, assume they're real and they're there. The safety benefits are co-benefits. EPA does not have any jurisdiction to regulate the safety properties of automobiles. Its only role in this area is to reduce the emissions of automobiles. So safety benefits, even if they were real, would be co-benefits from EPA's perspective. The Department of Transportation does have a regulatory jurisdiction over the safety attributes of cars, but not under the program under which this rule was promulgated. This rule is a product of the energy crisis in 1970, and it's solely about reducing our dependence on foreign oil. Whatever authority the Department of Transportation has over safety is under other statutory provisions that were not implicated in this rule. Just like EPA obviously has authority to regulate the particulate matter emissions of power plants. I mean, no one doubts that, not even the Trump administration, but their position with respect to the mercury or toxic standards was that that was under a different provision of the statute. So exactly the same thing here. So here's the second contradiction that comes out of all of this, which is that what the Trump administration is telling us is that the indirect benefits of regulation, the co-benefits of regulation, must be taken into account if they justify deregulation, but must be ignored if they justify regulation. So this is the second contradiction. I think by the time I put those two contradictions together, we can see that whatever the guardrails are, the Trump administration has driven right through the guardrails. No prior administration has ever used techniques this out of the mainstream, this arbitrary and capricious, to use a statutory term. And it's sort of an era of cost-benefit analysis we had never seen before. Now, before you think that the book is all about that, this is in one of six chapters in part two that documents in significant detail these aberrational practices. And the others are no less aberrational. In the interest of time, I won't go through them. I want to remain a friend of Dick's and not go over my time guardrail. So I'll stop here, but obviously in the Q&A, we can explore some of those others as well.
Great, Rick, and maybe just to touch on a couple more of the points that Dick raised before turning it back to you, Dick.
Well, Michael, you got about 4 minutes.
That's what I figured. Good. This conversation on guardrails is very good. It's keeping us on time because it's a good incentive to create a norm that we adhere to. So just kind of going forward, I mean, I think, you know, so Ricky does it, you know, and what we try to do in the book is provide a lot of detail here about the ways that the Trump administration departed from prior administrations. And now that with the election, we can kind of look forward and ask what can we hope to see in the future. So one of the questions that you posed to us, Dick, is this question of whether there are innovations that we'll see from the Trump administration that will have a lasting effect. And there's two things I want to say that. One is most administrations have really made lasting imprints. Administrations of Republican presidents, administrations of Democratic presidents. This includes the executive order under Bill Clinton. It includes Circular A4 under George W. Bush. It includes some innovations like the social cost of carbon, interagency working group under Obama. And so my sense and hope, frankly, is that the Trump administration will not leave much of an imprint on future administrations. And that's exactly an indicator of how outside of the norm it's been. Now, I think there may be some areas, you know, where, like, for example, somewhat expanded zones of OIRA review, so kind of more technical questions, less to do with the methodology of cost-benefit analysis and more about allocating responsibilities that are a little bit more normal and may survive this administration. But certainly the hope is that most of the methods, the really kind of hide the ball, shell game methods of the Trump administration go away. And that for this reason, I think there's hope that we can kind of reestablish something like the guardrails that existed before that truly can act as a constraint and help inform future decision making.
Great. Thank you, Michael. Well, it's right on time. I appreciate that. Okay, so now we're going to turn to our first commentator, who is Sally Katzen. Please take it away, Sally.
Thank you, Dick, and thank you for including me. I am delighted to be here with some of my favorite people at one of my favorite institutions. And I would like to pick up on some of the pieces from Mike's and Ricky's comments and add in a little more historical perspective and lessons learned in the process that seem to be pertinent today so that we can, in fact, look forward. Now, Michael mentioned the Clinton Executive Order 12866. And many of you may know that the conventional wisdom in 1993, when Clinton became president, was that he would rescind Reagan's Executive Order 12291 with its reliance on cost-benefit analysis and probably disband OIRA, which was fiercely criticized by many in his party as skewed towards deregulation. We didn't do that. I have often said that if OIRA didn't exist, we would have had to invent it, because the president has to know, and to the extent he can, has to influence what is being done in the executive branch for which he is responsible. As for cost-benefit analysis, we did not think it was inherently deregulatory or regulatory, albeit generally costs are easier to quantify and monetize than benefits, but the concept of considering all the consequences of a proposed action, pros and cons, and trying to convert them to a common metric is a fairly straightforward exercise. But we knew that we had to do more, a lot more, to have a fighting chance to survive the hostility of many of those in the president's own party. So we pushed timeliness and transparency and even selectivity. OIRA would only review so-called significant regs, not all regs, as under Reagan. And then over the next 7-8 years, we found, and I think we demonstrated, that cost-benefit analysis did not stand in the way of promulgating strong regs that would withstand judicial review. Now, flash forward through the Trump years that Ricky and Michael talked about, to the present, and an incoming Democratic president that has to consider what now. So because of the shift in support for cost-benefit analysis by some Republicans, not all, Biden will not get much credit for sticking with cost-benefit analysis, because many in the Republican Party have essentially abandoned it. They've abandoned cost-benefit analysis for costs, period. Trump's EO, the first thing out of the box when he became president, the 2-for-1, it mentioned costs 17 times. It mentioned benefits 0, never. And his idea for regulatory budget doubles down. It's costs only. So what's a person to do? Well, if you think the past is prologue, you might find the Biden team will keep the essential framework of 12866, which is, as my friends have acknowledged, getting fairly long in the tooth and might well deserve respect just for its longevity through Democratic and Republican administrations, but sweeten the pot with some serious substantive efforts in several areas that would be meaningful, particularly to the incoming president's constituents. For example, in 12866, it says something when we're talking about costs is that you should quantify costs and quantify benefits to the maximum extent possible, but you should consider costs that are not quantifiable, but nonetheless essential to consider. So working on that Executive Order 12866, we spent a long time with the thesaurus, I can hardly say thesaurus, to come up with the word essential. Pretty strong stuff, not desirable or lovely or interesting. but essential. Nonetheless, in practice and over the years, non-quantified costs and more particularly benefits have not gotten the same attention. They have not carried the same weight. They haven't gotten the same deference as quantified benefits. And I think people still gravitate towards numbers and those which have been quantified and monetized. Now, in part three of their book, Ricky and Mike talk a bit about doing more work on quantification of some aspects going forward. Good, okay. But maybe a mindset that can embrace non-quantified considerations, that is, change the conversation some, might be even more productive. And I would encourage those in this area to think about how to make that real. And more importantly, 12866 talks about equitable distribution. And Obama's executive order talked about equitable distribution. I think it's time to put some flesh on those bones, to do something real about it, to devote language in Circular A4, which Ricky mentioned, the primer in how to do a regulatory impact analysis on how to give real meaning to distributional equities. How will these and possibly other changes, modifications, or additions to the criteria for review be manifest? Will 12866 be amended the way Obama did, or will be rewritten from scratch? Time will tell. But there are a lot of steps that have to be taken immediately after the inauguration. And I suspect that rethinking or rewriting 12866, no matter how much consensus develops, will likely be postponed for the immediate future. You know, traditionally, the incoming administration has to issue a stop order as close to noon on January 20th as the chief of staff can make it, an order that freezes all ongoing work of the prior administration's regulatory actions, that is, calling back everything from the Federal Register that hasn't yet been published and sending everything at OIRA back to the issuing agency until someone in the new administration gives it a go ahead. And then there's the rescinding of all of Trump's regulatory executive order, especially the 2-for-1 and the regulatory budget and possibly the enforcement executive order, or should I say non-enforcement executive order. These executive orders become effective with a stroke of a pen and they can be rescinded along with all implementing guidance, again, with a stroke of a pen. And there are several strategies for dealing with Trump regs that are already issued, but which are in the courts and ways of challenging them. And all of these things, I think, deserve top priority to undo some of the damage that Trump has done. And more importantly, these are all highly time sensitive. So I suspect that they will take priority over the rewriting of 12866. I also think that the rewriting of 12866, if it occurs, would fall to the incoming OIRA administrator who has not yet been named and who stands behind the director and the deputy directors in the queue for confirmation. At least that's what happened in 93. And there's a decided benefit to some, even a modest delay, even if there isn't an informal vetting process that we undertook in 1993. Namely, try some of these things out in practice. OIRA can make that happen and learn from experience what is effective or not before you try to codify it. In any event, I want to respect my guardrails, my time limits on this panel. So thanks for listening and look forward to other perspectives and your questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Our next speaker is going to be my colleague, Alan Krupnik.
All right, well, thanks, Dick. And thanks, Sally. It's a pleasure to live through those old days with you when myself at CEA and you and people at Treasury, all the economists would get together and try to be sure that there was efficient regulation as much as possible in the Clinton administration. In fact, the change from the Reagan order to the Clinton order that I remember the most and being most important was moving from a strict cost-benefit test under Reagan to saying that the benefits need to justify the costs, but not that the benefits need to be greater than the costs. And I always thought that that was a really important amendment, because efficiency, after all, is only one element of a good rule. And it's possible that the distributional effects or other effects, or even the uncertainties associated with some of the effects that are calculated, are enough to justify moving forward with a rule, even though it doesn't pass a strict test. So I was very proud of that change. And I think that this, I agree with Sally, I think that this rule 12866 has stood the test of time until Trump came along. And basically, for all the words, basically decided he was just going to deregulate and then just would do whatever it took to move forward with that agenda, cost-benefit analysis be damned. So we'll only look at the costs, we won't look at the benefits. Or we will manipulate some of these analyses to make it come out the way we want. And so I think that that's basically the way I would explain what happened. So I wanted to make a couple of comments and use the on the book and use some of the recommendations in the book as a way of bringing up various topics. So. You know, really, this book is about the political economy of cost-benefit analysis. It's not about the methodology per se. It's got some elements of that, but it's primarily about the political economy of it. And as economists, we see cost-benefit analysis as, first of all, an accounting tool to array the benefits and costs, the advantages and disadvantages of a rule, but do them in the same units so they can be compared, in this case, in monetary units. And we also see cost-benefit analysis as an aid to the design of policy. So it can influence the stringency of a rule or even how it's designed to be as efficient as possible. And then it should be a tool that's politically neutral. It's basically a tool of good government. And I worry in the book a little bit that this separation between the tool itself and the agendas get blurred. Like there's one sentence that says, based on this lesson, it may seem obvious that the best course of action is to double down on the Obama strategy by going even further to integrate cost-benefit analysis with a progressive regulatory agenda. So to me, that gets me a little bit nervous. I think probably you guys would agree with everything I'm saying here, but I would want to see cost-benefit analysis as a tool that is in service of good government. And if it happens to come out, these analyses come out to favor a progressive agenda or a conservative agenda, so be it. That would make me kind of most comfortable. So I want to talk about ancillary benefits a little bit, particularly since Ricky spent so much time with it. This is a no-brainer from an economics perspective. You've got to count these benefits, whether or not the rule says that this is the purpose of, that the rule's purpose is. And this, of course, just displays Trump's deregulatory motive. But I want to say that the new rule that just came out yesterday, I believe, is a paper tiger. It doesn't say you can't use ancillary benefits in the analysis. It just says you have to separate them out from sort of the mainline benefits. So on the Mercury rule, it would be the Mercury benefits, and then ancillary benefits would be the benefits from reducing PM2.5 along with the Mercury. And that is not going to tie the Biden administration hands by my reading of this. Another 4 years of Trump, okay, it could have caused a lot of mischief. But in my view, it's not a problem. And I would say the same thing about the debate, and it's touched on in this rule, about the domestic social cost of carbon and the global social cost of carbon. Irrespective of what we might think about whether to use a domestic or a global, the rule requires that both estimates be included, or that if you're going to use the domestic, you can include the global. If you're going to use the global, you should look at what the domestic is. And there are some economic arguments for only using the domestic. I think they're outweighed personally, and we should by other arguments to use the global, but in any event, I don't think this rule is going to tie the new administration's hands. Similarly, there's been a lot of hand-wringing about threshold benefit models in, let's say, the relationship between PM 2.5 and mortality risks. And for there, you know, I don't have any trouble with using a threshold model to estimate your health benefits if the science supports it. But the problem in the Trump administration was that it was proposed to use these whether the science really supported it or not. So it's all about how you implement it. And then these transparency and disclosure rules that were basically designed to eliminate key PM 2.5 mortality studies. These studies are the best epidemiological studies ever done. You can't eliminate these studies from consideration in RIAs, but it does go to the larger question of how outsiders, academics, and stakeholders interact with these RIAs. And to me, I want to think about what FDA does in vaccine approvals and whether there's any kind of analogy there where they take industry's data and basically replicate the studies. And then if they can replicate it perfectly, then that's really good. Everybody trusts the industry analysis. And if they can't replicate it, that's a problem. And then they can also use their expertise to go beyond what the industry analysis says. So maybe there's an analogy there for EPA as industry in this case, and then stakeholders and academics as the FDA in the analogy. So a couple of more points. I think Sally maybe mentioned the idea of that's in the book, quantifying more benefits. And I couldn't agree more with this. And I wanted to highlight a couple of things. One is we need work on the value of statistical life. That key metric has not been re-looked at for decades. In terms of actually changing it it has been looked at, but nothing's really happened to it in many decades. And so that I think needs a relook. Another thing is that there are all kinds of chronic disease effects that really do not have monetary values. I'm thinking about infertility, I'm thinking about kidney disease and others, particularly that are linked to toxic substances. But there is a big effort going on now in the world, really, led by the OECD to estimate a lot of these health endpoints. So I think this is very important. And it also is important to understand that the United States government has not been funding these valuation studies. It's been very minor in the EPA's agenda or in NSF's agenda or whatever, but I think it should have much more focus. And the European countries are much more on top of this kind of work, and we really need it. And then on this idea about better distributional descriptions in RIAs, I couldn't agree more. Economists have really begun to step up developing models to do a much better job describing the income, the effects of regulations over income groups, and so on. And even at RFF, we've done some work on that. So, so I want to think about the future then under a Biden administration and pick up on a couple of things. And some of these things came out of the Trump administration, or at least were noted. One is retrospective analysis, the idea of looking backwards to see how well a regulation has performed. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think that's a very good idea. We shouldn't hold regulations sacrosanct. But of course, it has to be done for the right motives, which is good government, not as a way of trying to deregulate. Also, to do a better job on uncertainties, this is a perennial plea of academics and others for the RIAs to do a better job on estimating uncertainties. And actually, the new rule that came out yesterday on benefit cost analysis, I think does a pretty good job in suggesting and requiring ways of addressing uncertainties. So I'll applaud the Trump administration for that. And then I think overall, I think we're likely to return to the Obama era, which is also kind of the Clinton era, cost benefit analysis world, overturning these executive orders that Trump did, and re-enshrining the idea of justify as opposed to strict cost benefit test, removing any clouds on ancillary benefits. But you know, let's not get carried away here. There's still issues outstanding and some concerns that I have about a Biden administration or any Democratic administration. One is you want to see the cost benefit analysis have impact in the design of rules and in their stringency. So that means the analysis needs to be done early in the regulatory process so it can have effects on the policy itself, not just as a justification ex post. Also, I remember under the Clinton administration where Carol Browner, the head of the EPA then, really distrusted cost benefit analysis, thinking it underestimated benefits, overestimated cost, and distracted attention from more important criteria. So that may come up again, I think, as is implied here in the book. But I think that Biden can be trusted to take a science-based approach overall, and I hope we'll make decisions transparently regarding the weights given to efficiency and the other factors that should come in to deciding on what the regulations are and how they should be designed. So thanks a lot.
Alan, those are great comments. We'll stimulate a lot of questions, I'm sure. Our next speaker is going to be Joe Aldi. Please take it away, Joe.
Thank you, Dick. And thanks to you and Resources for the Future for hosting this event. I'd also like to thank Ricky and Michael for their fantastic contribution to our understanding of the role of benefit cost analysis in environmental regulatory policy. I want to start with a fundamental question that I think should motivate how our government addresses the failures and how markets operate. How can we promote a regulatory program that makes the lives of the American people better? Now, it's really hard for me to imagine how we can make progress in addressing this fundamental question without drawing from the insights of benefit cost analysis. Now, having said that, it's really important that we conduct benefit cost analysis in a credible manner, relying on the best science and economics, and to communicate to the public, be as transparent as possible so that they understand, so that key stakeholders understand, so that decision makers and members of Congress who originally wrote the laws that regulatory agencies are now implementing, so that we can all understand what are going to be the impacts of new regulations. Now, this does not describe, however, the approach to benefit cost analysis and rulemaking that I think we've seen during the Trump administration when it comes to environmental, energy, and climate regulations. Instead, I would describe the outgoing administration's approach as case studies in cooking the books. I think the defining characteristic of many of their actions in environmental, energy, and climate-oriented rules is to start with the answer, which is deregulate, or do the opposite of whatever the predecessor had done, and then attempt to justify these outcomes with their approach to analysis. At the start of the initial efforts, just a few weeks into the Trump administration, with the executive order that basically turns benefit cost analysis on its head by imposing this kind of arbitrary two rules out, one rule in standard for regulations and a regulatory cost budget. Now, there are some who've argued that if we have a budget on government spending, then we should also have a regulatory cost budget. But we need to recognize there is no intellectual basis for claiming that a regulatory cost budget is analogous to a government spending budget. Government spending is really a zero-sum game. When we think about the fiscal budget, Congress sets an overall spending level and for different agencies and different departments in the process of drafting an appropriations bill. And so within a given department or agency, spending on one program is going to reduce the available resources and expenditures that you could use for another program. But regulations, if well crafted, targeting market failures, can increase net social benefits. That means they increase the size of the pie. There's no reason to subject these kinds of rules that makes us, each one making society better off by having benefits greater than costs, to subjecting them to the same kind of zero-sum rationing of costs like we do the rationing of spending through the federal government appropriations process. Under the Trump regulatory cost budget then, what we get is we end up foregoing government action that might increase net social benefits. If we can't identify two existing rules that we would strike who has cost at least as large as the gross cost of the envisioned rule. What it means, we end up eliminating rules on the books now that have positive net social benefits in order to move forward with another rule with positive net social benefits. What this is really meant in practice is something that has approximated a regulatory moratorium with incredibly low action in the energy, environment, and climate space over the past 4 years. When it comes to cooking the books, as has been noted by a number of the previous speakers, this administration has been quite inconsistent in how it thinks about co-benefits. As Ricky noted at the beginning, in the context of the mercury and air toxic standards, earlier this year, the Trump administration struck the appropriate and necessary determination by deciding that the $33 to $90 billion of benefits associated with that rule were not really relevant to deciding whether or not it's appropriate to regulate mercury and air toxics. I actually find that analysis to be even more frustrating and unfounded in terms of the evidence when we go beyond the issue of co-benefits, however. They simply cut and pasted, if you will, from a 2011 analysis to go into an economic analysis in the year 2020, ignoring everything we've learned since 2011, which, as it turns out, the power sector is dramatically different in the year 2020 than what we expected it to be in 2011, in large part because of the tremendous growth of natural gas in the power sector with the cost reductions in the development of natural gas resources across our country. We've also learned a lot more in the evidence, in the scientific research about the public health, adverse public health impacts of being exposed to mercury that was not included in that 2011 analysis, that very well would have been incorporated in a 2020 analysis if you cared to look. But if you're just going to do copy and paste from a 2011 document, then you're going to ignore everything we learned in the intervening 9 years. But we also see cooking the books when we look at, say, consideration of co-benefits when it's, say, the methane, the regulation of methane emissions in the oil and gas sector. Here, they decided to walk back Obama-era regulations on methane emissions in oil and gas because they said, you're going to get the methane emission reduction benefits when we regulate volatile organic compounds. So they're going to find it when it suits their interests and the bottom line they want to then back up and try to justify in their analysis that final bottom line conclusion. I think it's all the more frustrating when we recognize what they're doing or failing to do with respect to fine PM, because some of the arguments that they have made in the past on why we shouldn't count co-benefits is that we should directly target the pollutant itself. And they have decided, though, to not take any action, despite the fact that regulating fine PM more stringently would clearly pass a benefit cost test, which I would suggest means we're failing benefit cost tests when we finalize rules that do not tighten the standard. Now, transparency has been a rhetorical focus, although I would acknowledge with a large dollop of irony of this administration when it comes to environmental regulation and benefit cost analysis. So I think the apparent intent, though, of this transparency initiative has been to reduce the consideration of fine particulate matter benefits in EPA air quality regulations. They've thought about this when we think about the rules that govern how we're going to use research that underlie the key studies, as Alan just referenced, and they say we should take all those data that are used in studies, the raw data about individuals in those studies, and put them in the public domain. They think about this in terms of how we are going to downweight consideration of co-benefits and how we present the information. We could saw this originally with their replacement for the Clean Power Plan. As Alan noted, this is in their recent rulemaking that just came out about air quality rules, benefit cost analysis. I think it's really disingenuous. It may not bind the Biden administration, but it's trying to influence the political debate about these rules by trying to make these second-class benefits, even though they are clearly benefiting people because of the reduction of exposure to air pollution, even if they weren't necessarily the target under the rulemaking. I also think, though, it's important for us to think about transparency to ensure that we have a credible research basis for the sound regulatory policy we need to develop. And I think, as is noted in some of the early questions Dick made at the top of our discussion here today, I think there are a lot of things we can do to improve and enhance the transparency of our research. Ella noted that in economics, we've made considerable strides on this, and I think that's quite true over the past decade. More and more journals require us to post our data and our statistical models so that others can replicate our work. I think that enhances the credibility. I think there's ways we can also do this to continue to ensure the confidentiality in those studies so that we don't give up private information about individuals, business confidential information, et cetera. We're able to do this in a wide array of research contexts. We can use federal statistical research data centers to do this so that we can ensure that we have confidence in the scholarship that's the foundation of our rulemakings without actually undermining then I think the appropriate privacy that has been afforded to individuals when they agree to participate in these studies or to businesses when we collect their data as a part of these evaluations. Now I'd say the leading and perhaps lonely redeeming approach to regulatory policy in the Trump administration has been the fact that it did not strike Executive Order 12866, which we've already heard much about here today. And so I see that as a foundation going forward for regulatory policy evaluation and coordination in the next administration. And going forward, I'd like to highlight three, I think, important contributions about the role of analysis in rulemaking. First, we should incorporate the best advances in both data and methods. I think we're gonna reflect the latest scholarship to ensure the credibility of our work. Some of this is gonna require us to update with the literature. As Alan said, it's been quite a long time since EPA has updated its use of a value of statistical life. Now, other agencies have been more recent in how they've done this, like the Department of Transportation, but EPA is still using an assessment of the literature where the most recent paper in their value of statistical life estimate dates from the year 1991. They have done work on this, they're aware of this, but there's something where I think we need to do more here, certainly. I think the social cost of carbon literature, understanding the damages of climate change is a fast-moving literature. There's a lot we can do to update that and how we can inform our evaluation of climate change regulations down the line. I also think on the cost side, we can do a lot more in better understanding how regulations operate in markets that are not perfectly competitive. The standard assumption in a lot of our benefit cost analysis is that these regulations are going into competitive markets, but in practice, that's not the case. And I think a lot of the economic literature that has evaluated regulatory performance has found how imperfect competition has influenced the effectiveness of some of these regulations. I think with the advances with data and methods, we can do a lot more to inform the understanding of the distributional consequences of regulations, as has already been noted by some of the other panelists. And I think we can really make this a lot more substantive in our guidance to EPA and other agencies, as Sally has noted. But I think this is a really exciting area of research that can then feed into, I think, an exciting area of policy analysis going forward. Likewise, I think there's a lot more in how we can characterize the uncertainty or the robustness of our rulemakings, as well as we draw off of some of the latest advances in data and methods. Second, I'd like us to be more creative about the scope and coverage of benefit cost analysis. There's a lot that we do, for example, to address climate change that's not just through regulations. And if we're gonna subject climate-oriented regulations to benefit cost analysis, we ought to be doing the same thing on tax policy. We ought to be doing the same thing on government spending. I think that kind of transparency and provision of information to the public would inform a much richer debate about how effective these different policy approaches are when we think about the whole toolkit available to the federal government. I think it can also help us better understand also the interactions across these instruments when we think about what's really going to be the true breadth of actions going forward to address climate change. Third, I think we should promote performance evaluation of our regulations. We've already heard some about this, about the value of retrospective analysis. I think there's more that we can do to institutionalize retrospective review and analysis of our rules. We can initiate this review by embedding it in the proposed rules. We should write research plans and data collection plans into the initial rule so that we can actually signal to the public how we plan to evaluate these rules going forward. We can learn from other agencies. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau has been doing this and is actually required to do this under Dodd-Frank. I think there's ways we can bring those insights into the energy and environmental space. And that can demonstrate with rigorous evidence which rules have really delivered on their goals and increased social welfare. It may help us identify those rules which we need to revise and make better and make them deliver more for the American public. But I think it'll end up being a key component to how we explain and make the case for regulation. And that's the last point I want to make, which is that benefit cost analysis really should be in the service to inform decision makers and the public about the actions our government undertakes on the public's behalf. We can do a much better job, I think, drawing from rigorous evidence to make compelling arguments why regulations are not a bad word, why regulations should not always be preceded by the modifier job killing, but instead why regulations mean we live longer, why regulations mean we actually work in safer environments, why we think that by this intervention in the markets through regulations, the government is making the markets work better for America. I look forward to our discussion. Thanks for having me again.
That was great, Joe. Thank you very much. Our final speaker today is going to be Jonathan Weiner. Please take it away, Jonathan.
Thanks, Dick. It's great to be here with you. Thanks to Dick and RFF for hosting this session. And thank you so much to Ricky and Michael for your terrific new book. It's really been a pleasure to read, even over what I was reading the drafts over the last year. And I signed it in my class and the students really appreciated it. So it's really a masterful treatment of the political economy, as Alan said, the political economy of cost-benefit analysis, but also of the way that the methodologies of cost-benefit analysis have been improved over many years and are able to better answer some of the questions we've just been discussing, and specific examples of how that's played out in agency rulemaking. So I highly commend the book. So a number of the points that I would make have already been made by previous speakers. I think there's a lot of agreement here, and that's a good thing. My starting point, similar to Joe's, is that the government has a responsibility to improve the general welfare, to promote social well-being. And yet we live in a complex world where we know that doing one thing doesn't have only one impact. It has multiple impacts. And so we need to think through the complex consequences of government policies. And so that basic idea that the government should make the world better, but needs to think through the pros and cons in order to make the world better. That's a longstanding idea that to me is really the origin story of the bipartisan consensus that we've been describing over the last several decades, but really goes back much earlier, at least to Benjamin Franklin in the 1770s, making this basic point. And this also, I see this also in the context of impact assessment. Impact assessment as a broad tool for government to think through decisions. And I mention that because that includes not only regulatory impact assessment, but also environmental impact assessment, both having more formal applications since the 1970s. And so those are both part of that bipartisan consensus. Of course, there's been a lot of debate about benefit cost analysis and environmental impact assessment, but there's been a remarkably strong emerging and then expanding consensus across presidencies of both parties since the 1970s, as Michael and Ricky were recounting. And I would go back before the Reagan administration to recall the Jimmy Carter administration's executive order and the enactment of NEPA, the National Environmental Policy Act in 1970, calling for environmental impact assessment. So this idea of good impact assessment, of good analysis to ensure that policies actually have the impacts we desire has a long and creditable history. And I also wanna highlight there the point that Sally made and Alan also about the advances that have occurred in these executive orders and other documents calling for impact assessment and the use of benefit cost analysis, notably the word justify that's in Executive Order 12866, which I also recall. I think I was at CEA the year before Alan in 1993, and I recall working very specifically on this effort as part of the team that Sally was leading to develop Executive Order 12866, and specifically that change from the word outweigh in the Reagan 12291 to the word justify in the Clinton 12866. And what that really stands for is that the analysis should be embracing of all the important impacts, not only those that we can count with high certainty, but also the uncertain impacts or the difficult to quantify impacts, the distributional impacts, which 12866 calls for, and that the exercise of regulatory authority is an exercise of judgment about the common well-being. And that the analysis, benefit-cost analysis, is a tool to inform those judgments, those decisions. It is not the judgments or the decisions themselves. So we should always be looking, as Joe was just saying, for ways we can improve the analytic methods to quantify more impacts, to take account of distribution as well as aggregate. And I'll mention a couple of other things later in my comments. So Dick Morgenstern asked us some questions, the first of which was, to what extent did the Trump administration really depart or diverge from this past consensus? And I think that that Ricky and Michael's book is very much on point here in identifying specific examples and of the contradictions, inconsistencies, departures from the past approaches, and that others have mentioned as well. Joe, just for example, omission of key benefits. And the way I see that is that this remarkable bipartisan consensus, at least across presidencies, was a consensus in favor of assessing the full impacts of policy options. And interestingly, some of that consensus has survived, has been retained in the Trump administration. For example, it did not rescind, as Joe just mentioned, did not rescind Executive Order 12866, although that could have been done any day of the last 4 years, did not rescind or replace Circular A4. So a Clinton executive order, a George W. Bush OMB Circular A4, or President Obama's Executive Order 13563. So all of those remain in effect today, and I think that offers a very good basis for the Biden-Harris administration to build back better, to restore the consensus. And where the Trump administration really departed was in disregarding impacts, was in to the extent that actions by OIRA or by agencies disregarded important impacts. That was a key departure from this consensus for full impact assessment. So that includes all kinds of specific agency rulemakings which may have disregarded impacts and which were often rejected in court, where judicial review found them wanting, including a number of cases that Ricky and the NYU Institute for Policy Integrity were litigating, a number of cases about climate change rules, where the court said the agency had failed to consider the full impacts. And I think interestingly and notably, on a totally different context, the Department of Commerce's attempt to add the citizenship question to the census when it got to the Supreme Court in June 2019, there's an opinion by Justice Breyer joined by three other justices that essentially says where an agency fails to consider an important impact of its policy option, that violates the APA as arbitrary and capricious. So I think that's the kind of rulemaking that's been getting rejected in court. And then there's the addition, as Sally highlighted, of Executive Order 13771, the one in, two out, or executive order which focuses on cost only and neglects the benefits. There are other examples of this, the changes to the social cost of carbon, omitting key impacts of the social cost of carbon. And also, I think we could note here the change to the CEQ, Council on Environmental Quality guidelines on environmental impact assessment, NEPA, to reduce the degree of cumulative impact assessment. So is there anything that would, Dick asked us, is there anything that will endure from the Trump administration? There might be some agency regulations on particular topics that will endure, maybe from FDA or even some from EPA on some issues and some other agencies. An interesting question that maybe the rest of the group might like to comment on as well is the development of what are being called rules on rulemaking, where agencies are issuing rules about how their own future rulemaking should proceed. And the rule issued yesterday by EPA about cost-benefit analysis under the Clean Air Act could be thought of as an example of that. There are also some others, Department of Transportation, Department of Health and Human Services, HHS, interestingly has proposed a rule on rulemaking that purports to put a sunset date on its own rules, that they would expire after a certain date if they're not reviewed within that time. And that raises some legal questions about whether an agency can do that to its other rules without going through them one by one. But I think that the major thing that's going to endure from the Trump administration is the invigoration of judicial review under the APA, calling for more full impact assessment, and moving more towards the view that several of us and Cass Sunstein and others have written about, of as the APA requiring a kind of at least generalized benefit cost analysis. And that's something that future administrations, including the Biden-Harris administration, will have to respect. That is the prospect that courts will demand full impact assessment. So last, I'll just mention on the hopes and fears that Dick asked us to talk about. Like Sally mentioning the experience back in 1993, I also remember that time when there were attempts to, or questions about abandoning the entire enterprise. And so I think one concern would be if the US government under any administration were to abandon the process of thinking through carefully the pros and cons of regulation, that would be undesirable and would worsen outcomes for the public. In terms of my hopes, I hope there'll be a return and a restoration, but actually even better, to full impact assessment. And that would include not only regulatory impact assessment of regulations proposed that OIRA then reviews, but also the use of benefit cost analysis to identify promising opportunities to improve. That is, so not only OIRA reacting to agency proposals, but also identifying opportunities for new policies. And there was a brief experiment in prompt letters back in the George W. Bush administration, interestingly, when John Graham was the head of OIRA. And that, I think, raises an interesting question about how benefit cost analysis could be used in a more even-handed way institutionally in the future. And on the point of even-handedness, I want to agree with, I think, everyone else here that co-benefits need to be counted. And I would, of course, add that countervailing harms also need to be counted. So the full ancillary impact, or let's just say the full impact. And that's a point that was highlighted in Circular A4, in the executive orders 12866 and others. And it's a point that several have written academic articles about. That point about full impact analysis, I think, can be seen as through the lens of benefit cost analysis of benefit cost analysis. That is, omitting any important impact can be a larger error than imprecision on the target impacts or the impacts that are assessed. And so disregard or omission of key impacts is really in derogation of the core idea of benefit cost analysis, which is to understand the full impact. I would add as well the distributional equity analysis that needs, that has been called for multiple times but needs work. And several of us, and I would note also work by Lisa Robinson and Jim Hammett and Dick Zeckhauser and Matt Adler on trying to work out how that could be done better. And then the last point I'll mention is that I would hope that the regulatory system can become more of a learning process. So that includes retrospective review, but going beyond retrospective review to regular periodic review, which occurs in some parts of the regulatory system, but not all, and to even further, planned adaptive regulation, where for some kinds of issues or problems where we expect to learn a lot, where we expect the world to change a lot, the science, the technology, public values, economics, that we would build in processes to adapt over time so that the initial benefit cost analysis does not become outdated and a mismatch with the changing world. And that's a topic that Lori Benier and I have been writing about. So I hope those are useful suggestions, and I look forward. Congratulations again to Ricky and Michael, and I look forward to the conversation.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much, Jonathan. We now have some time for some Q&A, and I'm gonna try to pull these up as quickly as I can here. So let's just take the first one. It looks like this person says that the benefit cost analysis has been used to avoid investment in lower income communities, often populated by people of color, because of the focus on the value of benefited properties rather than on the number of people helped. In what ways can we expect that distributional concerns will be incorporated in the practice of cost-benefit analysis that is more balanced? Does someone want to take that?
Sure, I'll get us started. So I take the question to be about a couple of, so one is about distribution and one is about efficiency concerns. So, or there's, let's just say, concern about efficiency criteria, okay? So one just kind of clarifying point I think is worth mentioning is if you look at how cost-benefit analysis, we'll accept the 4 years of the Trump administration and go back to the kind of the standard way of thinking about doing cost benefit analysis of, a major air quality rulemaking. For example, we've been talking about the mercury rule. So let's just use that. So what the standard technique is going to do is look at the, what the consequences of the rulemaking are, and then, and then value those consequences. Those are typically going to be, in the case of that rule in particular, the vast share, almost all of the benefits, the quantified monetized benefits of that rule was life-saving benefits to individual people. Right? So, this is well motivated, right? So because this is people, we care about living long and fruitful lives, and we're willing as a society to spend resources to reduce our mortality, to avoid unnecessary lives lost due to exposure to pollution. So that's kind of the standard technique for thinking about how to do cost benefit analysis. What would be, what we've been talking about a little bit is the fact that up till now, the distribution, who are the folks who are most likely to benefit from this rule? What kind of communities do they come from? What are the relevant characteristics about group membership that we should be taking into consideration, both, for example, on the benefit side and on the cost side? So, there's very good reasons to be more concerned, for example, about a cost that's imposed on someone who's not particularly wealthy than there is to be concerned about costs that are imposed on a very wealthy person. That doesn't necessarily mean that you can't do that, or that, there's going to be a lot that's going to be contingent and dependent in a particular rulemaking. But there are reasons to think about this stuff, take it into consideration, maybe affect your decision making, maybe affect some of your other decisions, think about priority setting and the like. And so in any case, that's just a very broad kind of response to some of those issues. I think Sally has a follow up.
Okay. Sally, is it? I'm looking at a long list of questions in very little time. You want to have a
very briefly? This was an issue that has been discussed a lot by a lot of the people who have been contributing policy papers to the Biden-Harris administration. And at the nub of it is something to build on what Joe was talking about, communications. Say more about what you're doing. So identify who bears the cost. Say who receives the benefit. Talk about what kinds of benefits they receive. In other words, elaborate on the thinking that is going into this that has always been more opaque than it should be.
Okay, that's a very fair point, Sally. Let me turn to a question here, which I think is directed to Joe. The question is, are co-benefits always a no-brainer? The questioner says the particulate co-benefits in the match rule are already regulated by the PM NACs. So when match reduced PM from power plants, state and local governments could relax PM regulations on other sources. Hence, there were no co-benefits. What do you say to that, Joe?
I think it's an empirical question. I think it's one where we actually need to do our analysis and figure it out. I mean, one of the key questions that is at the start of every benefit cost analysis that EPA does is what's the baseline? What's the counterfactual here? And so the first part is to make sure that whatever are the existing rules in effect, that you're accounting for those as part of your baseline for your analysis. The second thing that's important, and I think this is one where we do see some recent researchers trying to explore, gets to this issue that is raised by the questioner about whether or not there's a regulatory rebound. Whether or not as we decide to say achieve more fine PM benefits, say under the MATS regulation, does that mean that say some states, as they implement their fine PM state implementation plans, can they relax some of their requirements on their local sources of fine PM because they're getting some of the fine PM benefits now through this other federal regulation? I think that is something that should be considered and evaluated. I think some of what we've seen, in fact, with the recent decision not to regulate fine PM more stringently, despite the evidence that a more stringent standard would save thousands more lives a year, would suggest that you can have policies where we're fully complying with the fine PM NACs, and yet the benefits that are associated with fine PM reductions below the level of the NACs should still be accounted for in, say, the MATS regulation. So I think it is important to do the evidence, to do the analysis credibly, to make sure we're drawing in all the evidence, to make sure where there may be kinds of policy responses that may either amplify or reduce the effectiveness of a given regulatory intervention. But this all gets to how we can think about bringing the best insights, I think, from the scientific community, the economics community, the scholarly community, to ensure that policy evaluation that's being done by EPA, being done at other regulators, is really reflecting our best understanding of the science and the economics.
Okay, great, Joe. Thank you. Now, here's a question that I think maybe Alan, as well as Ricky, might want to answer. The questioner says, the view that benefit cost analysis is a nonpartisan tool ignores the fact that policymakers and interest groups have a strong input into the choices about what costs are considered and what benefits are considered. How can you get around that problem?
Well, first of all, I just want to say on the no-brainer point, I have to say just a little thing, which is the main issue with ancillary benefits, problem with it is about double counting. You don't want to double count a PM10, a PM2.5 reduction in one rule when you've already captured it in another. And that's not what the questioner is really getting at. And EPA is very scrupulous about this and careful to not double count. Now on this thing with interest groups, there's always pressure from outsiders on both sides or multiple sides of an issue to advance particular types of costs and benefits. But in my estimation, the conduct of cost-benefit analyses, RIAs, by agencies have a core group of economists who are doing this. And I don't know, maybe I sound Pollyannish, but I think they're pretty good at figuring out what the appropriate benefits and costs to consider are. Now, sometimes the tools aren't there or the information isn't there to calculate them appropriately or even do it at all. But for instance, EPA has a program it uses, a computer program called BenMap, that encapsulates all of the best science that's available on the health sides of pollution reductions. So, you know, that's wheeled in each time, that's subject to peer review. So I give the agency fairly high marks for insulating itself under normal times from the pressures from the outside.
Okay. Ricky, you want to take a shot at that, the selection of categories of benefits and costs, whether that's subject to too much interest group effort or input?
There are always interest group efforts. The question is whether those efforts should succeed or whether the institutions that are designed to ensure that analysis is properly done stand in the way of those efforts. So I'll give you one example from this administration. This administration tried to repeal the so-called Obama tip rule that had to do with who got to share in tips that customers gave at restaurants. And one of the things this administration would have allowed is for the owners to keep the tips. And now there was an empirical study, not surprisingly, suggesting that if people knew that the owners were going to keep the tips, they were going to tip less. Now that empirical study was extremely relevant to the analysis of the impact of the rule, as you might imagine. Well, there was an interest group that pushed the Department of Labor into pushing OIRA into approving the publication of a proposed rule that omitted any reference to that study or its implications. And OIRA got rolled by the Department of Labor by the interest group. So that, you know, this sort of supports the questioner's view that interest groups tried to do that. What was considered unusual enough to merit a big article in the Wall Street Journal, was that OIRA was rolled. That's exactly the role of OIRA. OIRA should have said, we cannot let this rule go forward unless all of the consequences are taken into account. And when they are, this rule is gonna look very different. And that didn't happen. But that goes to like what I would call Trump administration exceptionalism with respect to cost-benefit analysis, exceptionalism in a bad way, obviously, and not to something that's inherent to the way the technique and the institutions work.
Okay, that's great, Ricky. We're running close on time here. I think I've got maybe one more question probably to get in, fit in. This is a question about Republican concerns about putting more emphasis on individuals harmed by regulation and somehow thinking about compensating them. I wonder if any of the panel members want to take a shot at that. All right, I'm hearing a deafening silence, so I'll switch to another question.
So Dick, maybe just very quick, I don't want to, you know, I think we just, so one just point is that the regulatory system is very big. There's a lot of regulations. And so the kind of theory behind cost benefit analysis is that we, you know, sometimes people experience costs, sometimes people get benefits. And we don't, for every individual rule, try to compensate people. Oh, you have some costs, let's try to pay you here, but then you have benefits over there. So we tax it and redistribute it. That'd be just enormous waste of money, enormous waste of time. That having been said, if there are groups that consistently do not benefit by the regulatory system or are consistently imposed with unfair costs, this is exactly what distributional analysis that we've been kind of been talking about would help us address.
All right, that's a nice point. All right, the last question here is a methodological question. There is a whole bunch of them. Let me try to lump them together. One person is asking about non-use or passive use values, how to increase their importance in future analyses. Another person is asking about placing more emphasis on the willingness to pay for estimation of certain benefit categories. Let's see, maybe Alan is a good person to try that one quickly.
Yeah, I mean, the academic community that estimates these non-use values and tries to put values on non-quantifiable health effects and other types of effects, would love to see programs where and funding where more of that can be done, and would love to see a cooperative OMB and particularly OIRA to approve in an easier way surveys of the population to figure out their willingness to pay. But currently that process is extremely cumbersome. And these valuation exercises are have a low priority.
Okay, that's a nice succinct response. I think we're kind of at the end of our time here. So I want to bring this event to a close and thank everybody. Certainly thank the speakers, Michael, Ricky, Sally, Alan, Joe, and Jonathan. And thanks for the audience for hanging in there and asking some quite serious questions. This event was recorded, as I indicated, and it can be re-seen and in full at the RFF website. That's rff.org with probably a short time lag. So thank you very much. And that's it. Bye-bye.
Thanks,
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike, for your book. Great book.